Welcome to the stage, Stephen Bruce, Olivia Thirlby, Jocelyn DeBoer, Martin Starr, and David Krumholtz.
Nice.
Well, first of all, this is the second time I've seen the film, and I liked it even more this the second time. And you were just commenting outside.
Kind of. For me, it's gotten better every time, and I know that's weird to say because I'm an never seen the movie, so it's a totally disgusting thing to say. But I'm shocked that it's good at all, because we shot it in 15 days.
15 days.
And, it was a pretty wild shoot. And I thought, this could be awful. But Bob pulled it together in a nice way, you know?
And well, how'd this come about? Incredible. How'd this come about for you?
I've known Bob since I was 19. He didn't like me, I didn't like him for a long time. We rubbed each other the wrong way. But then he came around once he thought I might be talented, which took a long time. Well, yeah. And I was in this movie that he made called Francis Ferguson, which was the last film he had made before this one. And he came to me and he said, I want you to play Kaminsky. And I said, okay. And I had a good take on Kaminsky. And then he was like, hey, the guy that we want to play Lousy dropped out. And like, you want to do it? And I was like, sure. And then, it was a bit of a more of a square peg in a round hole, that role, when I read it. I thought, I don't know how to do it. But then he cast Martin as Kaminsky. And I was like, oh, that kind of made the whole thing make sense, because Martin's an inspiration, to me personally, and and always has been, and always will be. I was like, oh, well, I kind of think I know what Martin's gonna do, so then I can do my thing, and hopefully it's not. And yeah, that's it. It came out good. Hallelujah.
Martin, what was your take when you read the screenplay for the very first time?
I'll use this. Bob just sent me the script and he said, pick whatever part you want to do. That's what he says every time, but he has something in mind, I feel like. And somehow this is where we landed. Great story, right? Once he told me that David was playing Lousy, then everything kind of fell into place as well. I think it's easy to see. It's not a compliment what I was about to say, so I pulled the reins on it. It's easy to see you as a performer in a movie like this. I think the tone became a lot more clear once I knew that David was in it. Because I don't know if you've seen Bob's other movies. They're all kind of different. So it was really fun to watch how this one came together. And how many edits of this have you seen?
I've seen the movie like 8 times. And I really cringe at the idea of doing that, much less doing it. And I gotta say, it kind of gets better every time, which is weird and rare.
Bob re-edits it every time.
He keeps re-editing it. So there was a version of the film in which the ending was a lot more dramatic. And that was what was in the script originally. And I bristled when I read it. And I called Bob and I said, man, that's a hell of a doozy of an ending. How are you going to make that work? And he didn't know. And he said, I wrote it from my unconscious. And I said, you mean your subconscious? And he said, my unconscious! And I thought, that's not a thing. So I was concerned about the ending. And we shot the ending as it was written. And it involved a very long melodramatic speech that I give about the nature of life and death. And there was no Folgers can at the end thing, you know, smashing to the Folgers can. And so when I saw that version, I said, oh boy, you know, I called him and I said, what do you think? And he said, it doesn't work. And I said, no, it doesn't. And, you know, I didn't want to do the I told you so thing, but it was pretty obvious that it wouldn't. And then Bob and I kind of tossed around some ideas and came up with the more sort of blunt comedy version of this ending as best we could. And I think it works now. Yes.
It works great. What a fun.
Yeah, the ending definitely works.
Yeah, very strange line to end on.
I can't imagine it being more dramatic than it already is. That's pretty dramatic the way it already
Well, ends. My character, like, it gives a whole speech about the nature of life and death and about clouds and shit. And I was like, well, what the fuck is this? What movie has this become? You know, Bob is the only filmmaker who can get away with a major tonal shift, but this was even gilding the lily for him. It was a major tonal shift, so... I'm glad that it's what it is now. And I think Bob is really proud of it, which is great.
So Jocelyn, I want to ask, like, when you all got together, because you only had a 15-day shoot, which is, like, insanely short, even by indie movie standards, did you have time to rehearse, or did you just jump right in?
That's a good question. I did not rehearse.
No.
we did something. But there was such a camaraderie between the cast, and we all hung out, and Bob, you know, we did a table read actually in LA long before, but yeah.
So in terms of like doing a table read, you know, you're reading through, and a lot of times, well, just from what I've experienced with other conversations, especially in the indie world, scripts evolve, characters evolve, relationships evolve, like there's happy accidents during a table read, oh, let's put that in. Did that happen at all? Or was like Bob's script like, nope, this is it, that's no changes?
No, it absolutely evolved and changed. The cast changed quite a bit. I'm not joking, it did. It was a really early table read and different people read parts.
Oh, I see.
What?
It was at Joel McHale's house, and he was playing Lousy Carter at that point in time. It was a different movie.
He's a terrific actor himself, obviously, comedically.
Yeah, no, he is, absolutely. But wait a minute.
He has hair plugs.
Yeah. But when you see a film and you can't imagine anyone else in the role, that's when you know they got the right person. So who cares who else was
very
cast?
Well said.
It's
yeah.
The truth. It's the truth.
And
please.
On that note, shout out to Luxy Banner. Because so the person who was initially going to be playing Gail actually fell out right before filming, and Luxy was employed on the set in a different capacity. She was working as a PA. And she...
That's
everyone
amazing.
Kind of turned to her, and she stepped up, and this was my first time seeing the film tonight, and I thought she was so fantastic. Okay. So give a hand to Luxy
Banner. She was fantastic.
Luxy was lovely to work with, too. She's a wonderful person.
You know, Olivia and Steven, you know, the both of you have worked on films. I mean, all of you, really, all shapes and sizes, indies, you know, big budgets. And congrats on the winning Best Picture, you know, and that kind of thing.
Why, thank you.
thank you very much.
But
do you mean the Weisenheimer picture?
Yeah. Mm? But Steven, I want to ask about Bob's, like his process, like working with Bob as a director, what makes him unique?
Yeah, I've done maybe three or four films with Bob, and they're all completely tonally different, and that's what's fun to go down there and play in a smaller, you know, in a smaller place and being able to do really small stuff. I love the fact that the tone of this was so under. And I think that's one of the reasons why it's better every time, because it's there's no part of it that's really overdone except the ending, and that got fixed. So I don't remember the question.
You answered it anyway, so you're good.
Excellent.
You're good. Olivia, I want to ask about the freedom that you had to develop your characters. I mean, obviously, you know, you got a screenplay and you're following the screenplay, but you know, how much freedom did you have to bring your own like ideas into your characters?
Well, the one thing I can say is that when I came to do it, there wasn't talking about an accent or not, and I said I'd kind of like to do this one, and so I did it for him, and he looked up at the sky and he said, "I am 73% sold on the accent," and he let me do it for the first couple of takes, and he said, "Okay, then you can do it."
I loved it. I did not know you were going to have an accent in the film, and I thought it really rounded out that character beautifully.
Did you know he was going to have an accent when you sat down with the scenes?
No, but he's Stephen Root, man. It's like a dream to work with Stephen Root. So you let Stephen Root do whatever the fuck Stephen Root wants to do, basically.
By the way, Stephen Root is in the room. Happy 25th anniversary to Office Space, everybody.
Oh, yeah, there we go.
You know, watching Lousy Carter, you know, especially during the eulogy scene, and there's quite a few scenes where you have a lot of dialogue. One question I've kind of gotten in the habit of asking in situations like that is, How do you remember your lines?
Well, okay, so here's what happened. Bob is a stickler for every word. So, you know, he's like Sorkin in that way, I guess. And and he writes, so like, there's a moment where I say the thing about, you don't think you're gonna die, you think that you're not going, that's written. That's not me messing up that he writes so specific. And he's really adamant about making sure you know them. But, you know, I'm human. And it was hard. So what I did was, there was a script supervisor on set, young lady, and I said, listen, the only way to get through this, shooting it in 15 days, I'm in every scene of the movie, is to meet up with this person and, you know, after work and rehearse. So my day ended on set, and then another 3 hours of just running lines with this young lady, Amelia Brum, who is terrific and lovely. And she was very kind and patient and really a good reader. And then I would come in the next day and I'd make one little mistake and Bob would yell at me. quite often, my interaction with Bob on the set of this film was really contentious. That's just the truth, and Bob would not deny that. I was frustrated with myself in not remembering every little bit of dialogue, and he was wildly frustrated with that as well, and he's prone to throwing hissy fits, and there was a lot of telling him to calm the fuck down, shut the fuck up at points. We yelled at each other quite a bit, but the thing about Bob is that if you yell at Bob, he kind of loves it. He loves being scolded. You see it on his face. He kind of goes, He likes to make you angry. But it created an urgency that might have not been in the performance, because I just wanted it to be done.
Wow.
I just wanted, you know, by end of week one, I thought, I just wanted to go back home. And the quickest route to doing that was to get everything right. To get all the dialogue right.
And now you know why it was shot in 15 days. You just like rush through it, yeah.
Oh, madness. But I love Bob very much. No, I do. He's an incredible writer. He really is an incredible writer. And, you know, he's, what an intrepid person. All his movies are made ultra low budget. You know,
he could have given up a long time ago. He really, I mean, and yet he soldiers on and convinces people to give him money. And I honestly admire the shit out of him. And Bob and I have a lot in common, it turns out. Mainly, the main thing we have in common is we both live in a perpetual state of embarrassment. Really. And it crushes us. And I knew that's what this film was about, because this, in a lot of ways, is his most autobiographical film.
Did it say based on a true story? In the beginning?
Which is bullshit. Yeah. It's not based on a true story at all. That's him kind of playing with the trope of based on a true story, is that it's not actually based on a true story. But I'll speak for Bob and say he wrote it during the pandemic when he started to have feelings about death. And so that's what inspired this sort of idea of what if a guy, you know, finds out he's going to die. And what I loved about what we were simpatico on in the interpretation of that was I read it without him telling me what he wanted. And I said, I think I should play it like he's super relieved to be dying. You know, rather than playing the worry or neurosis or the urgency, this was a guy who was very successful at one point, never quite lived up to that success again, was clearly an egomaniac at some point, a drunk asshole to his friends, because throughout the movie, his mother, his best friend, all the people in his life tell him that they don't like him. And so the best of his life is well behind him, and he's convinced that there's nothing better to come. So when he finds out he's gonna die, there's some relief, like, thank, you know, goodness this is over, and before I go, I'd like to try and get laid and teach my favorite book. It's not more complicated than that.
No, it's really
and
not.
I kind of love that, and he totally agreed. That's what he wanted, so we didn't disagree on that, at least.
So, Martin, I got to get your take on working with Bob. Is it, does it gel with David's?
You asked the right guy. Well, shit. I mean, it's accurate. I witnessed a lot of it. But I don't have the same relationship with Bob. He treats me very different than he treats David. But I've witnessed him act this way with the leads of his movies before. I think he just struggles with the stress of movie making. Mm-hmm. And I think he unfortunately takes it out on the person who he sees the most.
So there you go. Yeah. Wow.
Thank you, Martin.
Jocelyn, I want to ask, like, you know, when you're watching a film, you know, that is just so all about the performances and about the dialogue, and you're rehearsing yourself, you're memorizing your lines and prepping for how you're going to play, you know, your character, but then you get on the set and you're working with someone like David, how does that sort of elevate your performance beyond what you were even prepared to do?
Working with David, what I was so impressed with actually is you really wanted to run things several times, which, you know, actors don't always want to do, and I thought that was so nice because, of course, as an actor, you want to be listening and reacting in the moment to what's actually happening. And I did with Bob's script, I really tried to memorize every single punctuation mark, you know, in every word. And I found that, working with David and working with Martin, they were so giving in being like live wires, so to speak, sure, that I could just be present and react to what was actually happening. And I thought it was so fun to play ball, so to speak, that from take to take, it felt like we were really, dancing together in the same scene. So.
Yeah, I'm just getting this depiction. I mean, I've never met him, but certainly.
Never met Bob?
I've never met him. I'm kind of glad I didn't. But Olivia, what makes Bob like a great actor's director for you?
I had a blast on this film, actually. I had the loveliest couple weeks in Austin with all of you folks, and I enjoyed my working relationship with Bob a lot. I think he's just such a good writer. I mean, what you're seeing, none of this is improvised, none of these jokes. They're all delivered as they were scripted, and I this character just had such incredible lines that my experience of working with him was just trying to do justice to whoever this person was. And she is based on a person in his life. I mean, it just seemed like she already existed. So I was trying to do her justice, and the deadpan thing is really fun for me. I hadn't tried it at this extreme level before, and and I loved it. Wow.
You know, movies, obviously, as we all know, are usually not shot chronologically. They're shot out of order, you know, whatever works best for the budget, especially in a movie like this. So Stephen, I'm curious if you shot your scenes with David in a day or two, you know, so you could, you know, maximize your
time.
Yeah,
it was probably no more than, 3 days, David?
Yeah.
At the most, because I was doing another project at the time. But that's how I've done all of his movies.
Right.
And that's been fun. I started down there doing the first, Seven Chinese Brothers, I think, was the first one I did. But I had shot Office Space down there, and Mike Judge lives down there, who is my savior. And to be able to come down and work with another director, and just, I have friends in the town who are, you know, theater actors in Austin. So it's always a pleasure to come down and work on something fun, small, and good. And so I'm always up to come down and work with Bob, because as everyone has said, he's very particular and he's very odd, but he writes really well.
Yeah.
he writes really well. And he didn't beat me up so much as a director.
Because you've worked with him a few times.
Yeah,
now,
I think so.
Do you have like a I don't want to say I guess it is a shorthand.
Yeah, it's a short speak, you know. It's like when any actor when a lot of actors are directing, you can short speak with them as well. But I can do that with Bob as well, I think.
You know, I want to go back to the eulogy, because I just thought your delivery of that was just magnificent.
Hey, thanks.
How many takes did you wind up doing for that?
Oh, a good few. You know, you don't have time, so you got to get it right. You know, we did a good few takes. We did a few takes. Probably 5, 6. Yeah, different little versions with different little tweaks, but then, you know, yeah.
So, you know, a lot of times you hear actors talk about how they got into character, and some people can just turn it on and shut it off when, you know, they say cut. Some people like to stay in the character. But for you, especially, it's more interesting than getting into character as Lousy Carter. How did you get out of it? Like, you wrapped 15 very intense days,
it sounds
like. Like
I said, I couldn't wait to get the hell out of there. But I can't stress that enough. But, you know, be honest with you, the biggest challenge of this for me was Bob said, I want you. And I always sort of do the sneaky thing, which is find an affectation or an imitation or a character choice that separates me from who I play, like a character actor. And he said, I want you. And that kind of made it harder and easier at the same time. It made it more it made it more of an insecure experience, because I wasn't sure if what I was doing was good. And Bob didn't help by
torturing me and telling me I sucked the whole time. But well, he didn't tell me I sucked, but it was very hard to gain his approval. You know, I'll be honest. I'm not a big believer in, like, the character stayed with me. Although I think that happens sometimes, and it has happened to me since. But not on this one. I was the hell out of there. I just wanted to, you know. Plus, I think Bob creates an environment in a weird way of, like, let's none of us take ourselves too seriously. I don't think Bob tolerates dramatic behavior from his actors. So if I was to come to set and say, this is killing me, and I need to find my space, and can I have some quiet? He would hate me more than he had already. And so that wasn't necessarily a thing I worried about. I was done when I was done.
Can I say this? I think the most important thing you said to me was exactly how I feel. It's like the hardest character I've had to do was me, just doing me, because there's nothing to hide behind. It's just straight truth. And as a character actor, it's like, what? I don't know if I can do that. I would love to know how these guys feel about that, of just playing themselves or a character.
You know, making this film, Olivia, like, I mean, it sounds like it was a very interesting shoot, especially for you. But how proud are you of this movie?
Oh, I'm so proud of this movie. I think, first of all, David, you're so good in this
Stop
film.
Stop it. Cheer it, everybody. Hey.
Thank you, Olivia. That's so nice of you. Thank you. I'm terrible at taking compliments, especially publicly, but thank you so much. I
pretty good
it.
Right now. We could keep going, should we? Should I keep telling you why I like you?
No, please stop. Okay. Let Martin do more of it. Martin is sitting there judging me mercilessly. Thank you. I love you.
How about you, Jocelyn?
I do also feel so proud of this film and so admiring of Bob Byington as a filmmaker for many of the reasons David pointed out already, but I think all of us in this community know how very hard it is to make independent films, and we need filmmakers like Bob who are willing to just do it. And it's
One more thing too, the crew on this film was so spectacular. You know, this is, and young, and this is...
Wildly young.
This is not a set where people are there because they're making money. This is the kind of project where everybody is there because they want to be, and because they're interested and passionate and talented, and all the people working on this film were just absolute gems.
Yeah, I thought about that too, because watching the credits, you know, with the, you know, obviously you got the bonus scene, but the credits were not very long.
Yeah, no, it was a small, tiny crew. But I want to give major props to Magnolia for believing in the film. Like, that's big deal. Because this kind of film turns a lot of people off, a lot of buyers off. Unfortunately, you know, there's no flashiness. It's just, but they believe in the tone, they believe in the uniqueness of it, and it's just really, really deeply appreciated.
Martin, how proud are you of the movie?
Hello?
Martin's amazing in this movie.
I was worried once, you know, it's a movie about a pedophile.
Nobody wants to see that.
On the cusp. Not technically, but we're close. No, we're not. Look. It's all in the details. I love how self-aware it is. I mean, the ending, that last line being the line, I think really just shows how self-aware it is. I don't know. I love this movie. I'm really proud of it. And it really has gotten better every time I've seen it. I think this is the third iteration of it I've seen. And Bob did this with the last movie I did with him as well. I noticed that every single time I saw it, he was re-editing it. Little tweaks here and there. And the on this one, it was the ending. The ending changed dramatically in such a profound way.
Go on. I just want to say, I've known Martin for coming up on 26 years. And we've gotten to a point in our relationship where we can't keep a straight face around each other without anything being said. We just can't keep a straight face. And Martin came on the last week of the shoot when I was a little forlorn and beat up. And his performance and his presence really just kind of saved the day for me. So I just love Martin Starr so much. I love Martin Starr. I'll always love Martin Starr. Easy to love.
So, ladies and gentlemen, Lousy Carter is available everywhere March 29th. And now that you've seen the film, spread the word, go on social media. You know, if you're still using Facebook, knock yourself out. Thank you all for being here, and thank you to this incredible panel. Thank you all so much. This is awesome.